And now onto our dinosaur of the day, Amurosaurus, which was a request from FuzzyPickles03 via our Patreon and Discord. So thanks. It was a Lambeosaurine hadrosaur that lived in the Late Cretaceous in what is now Russia, in the Udurchukan Formation. Now, it looked similar to Corythosaurus. It's got a bulky build, duckbill, strong legs. It mostly walked on two legs, so it was a facultative biped. Like it could walk on four legs when necessary. Amurosaurus was estimated to be about 20 feet or 6 meters long. Gregory Paul estimated that it was 26 feet or 8 meters long and weighed 6,600 pounds or 3,000 kilograms. It probably had a hollow crest on its head, but the crest hasn't been found. It was herbivorous and had a dental battery. Its maxillary teeth were, according to the paper, quote, narrow, diamond-shaped, perfectly straight, and symmetrical. It also had a massive coracoid, which is part of the shoulder, a robust ulna, part of the forearm, a gracile radius, which is the other part of the forearm, and a robust femur.
So mostly robust, except for that radius, which is inexplicably gracile.
Yeah.
I guess that could be partly why we think it was bipedal a lot of the time, if its arm wasn't super bulky for supporting weight.
It also had elongated pencil-shaped metacarpals, which in the hands, and robust metatarsals in the feet. The type and only species is Amurosaurus riabinini. It was described in 1991 by Yuri Bolotsky and Sergei Kurzanov. The genus name means Amur lizard, and it comes from the Amur River near where Amurosaurus was found. It's called the Heilongjiang or Black Dragon River in Mandarin, and this river is the border of Russia and China.
No, I never knew that. That's a fun fact in and of itself.
Yeah, bonus facts here. And the species name is in honor of paleontologist Anatoly Ryabinin.
We've talked about him. He was super important.
Mm-hmm. Now, all the fossils of Amurosaurus were found in one bone bed that was discovered in 1984. A brief history of the area. In 1902, Colonel Monikin collected the first dinosaur bones. These are isolated bones from Cossack fishermen near the Amur River on the Chinese side of the river. In the summers of 1916 and 1917, the Geological Committee of Russia excavated the area, and in 1925 and 1930, Ryabinin said that the hadrosaur bones were abundant in the area, and he named two, Trachodon amurens and Saurolophus christofovici, which are now both considered to be nomina dubia because they're too fragmentary and they don't have really any unique features. In 1957, Rozdestvensky first mentioned dinosaur fossils from the Russian part of the Amur region. In 1984, Yuri Bolotsky and the Amur Complex Integrated Research Institute of the Far Eastern branch of the Russian Academy of Sciences found a large bone bed in the area, which brings us to Amurosaurus. As of 1991, only 200 square meters had been excavated, but they found several hundred bones, mostly from Lambeosaurines, and 90% of those belong to Amurosaurus. They're mostly juveniles.
Awesome. I would say 200 square meters is a lot of area.
Yeah, but I got the feeling that this was a large area.
Like there's even more to be found if they keep going?
Mm-hmm.
Wow, that sounds awesome.
So the rest of the bones found so far are hadrosaurines, like Kerbersaurus. They also found turtle fragments and theropod teeth and many tooth marks on the bones from predators or scavengers.
Oh, wow.
So in 1991, Bolotsky and Kurzanov described some of the Lambeosaurine fossils as Amurosaurus riabinini. And they said more than 90% of the bones found are from Lambeosaurines, but, quote, these skeletons are complete, disarticulated, and mixed, end quote.
Complete, disarticulated, and mixed. I assume those are different individuals, like some of them are complete, some of them are disarticulated. Oh, but then mixed.
No, these are, I think they meant the group, because so it's based on the skeletons being mixed up and the way that the long bones were oriented. The bones were probably deposited in a river or floodplain kind of environment. But because the bones are so well preserved, including fragile skull pieces, they probably weren't transported over a long distance.
Interesting. Okay. So there's like a complete skeleton, but it's jumbled up with a bunch of other complete skeletons.
Yeah.
Interesting.
And the random way that the bones were oriented may mean that they were suddenly stopped in being transported before fossilizing.
Hmm. That does make it really tricky to do any sorts of comparisons between individuals when they're all mixed up like that.
Yeah.
Like, I guess it gives you a really good sample for the species and the genus in this case,
mm-hmm.
because it's like, okay, well, it's not just one individual. We can compare like these 10 femur or femora and say, okay, on average, this is the femora, and you could pick the best one for your holotype or something like that. But you can't get a lot of details about any of the individuals, it seems like.
Yeah, they kind of got an idea of the sizes roughly of individuals, but...
Oh, true, yeah. Because if they're all different sizes, then you might be able to match it decently well.
Yeah. You're right, though. It gets tricky because only the holotype skull pieces and some vertebrae are known for sure to be from the same individual.
Okay.
So that's how it became the holotype.
Yeah, like they picked the skull that looks like it's kind of articulated with a few vertebrae, and they're like, okay,
yeah,
that's the biggest, best chunk we can know is from one individual, so that'll be our holotype.
So that holotype is the left maxilla, the upper jawbone, and dentary, the lower jawbone.
Hmm.
And the holotype skull has sutures.
Okay, so probably an adult, or at least more likely.
Maybe. But again, so many bones were found in the bone beds that they could construct most of the skull and skeleton, which is why we have a pretty good idea of what Amurosaurus looked like. There are a lot of unique features in the skull and the shape of the lower arm bone, the ulna, which was that robust part. There also were bones on the roof of the skull that seemed to support a crest. So even though a crest hasn't been found, it seemed like there should have been something there. In 2004, Pascal Godefroy and others redescribed Amurosaurus, and they said that based on Lambeosaurine, like Lambeosaurus, Corythosaurus, Nipponosaurus, and Parasaurolophini, like Parasaurolophus and Charonosaurus, which are dinosaurs that are found in North America and Asia, it seems that there was a lot of migration between Asia and North America, but it's not always clear which way they went, if they went east to west or west to east. But all known basal Lambeosaurines are from Asia, so it seems that Lambeosaurines originated in Asia. In 2011, Pascal Goldfried and others wrote about recent advances on the study of hadrosaur dinosaurs in Heilongjiang, and they found that less than 2% of the bones excavated from the Amurosaurus bone bed had potential tooth marks. So scavenging there was either limited or there was so much food for the scavengers that they didn't have to scrape at the bones.
Scavenger satiation.
Mm-hmm. They could be picky.
Yeah.
Now, based on the size and frequency of femurs, tibiae, humeri, and dentaries, there are mostly late juveniles and subadult Amurosaurus. It's possible that younger Amurosaurus lived separated from the adults and then rejoined the herd when they were more grown. So most of these individuals found were small to medium size, but some isolated bones suggest that Amurosaurus could get large, maybe even larger than Shantungosaurus giganteus, which was up to 48 feet or 14.7 meters long.
Yeah, that's the craziest one.
Mm-hmm.
Edmontosaurus is getting up there too.
Yeah, but if there were more dinosaurs that got that large, yeah.
That'd be cool.
So Amurosaurus lived in savanna-like valleys with oasis vegetation along the banks of lakes and rivers in a warm and relatively arid climate. You can see an AR view of Amurosaurus with Google's Arts and Cultures Meet an Ancient Animal feature if you want to get a better idea of how it might have looked.
Cool.
For those of you who listen to our Dinosaur of the Day segment and you like it, please consider becoming a patron. We take new Dinosaur of the Day requests from our patrons and offer a bunch of other perks as well. So check out our page at patreon.com/iknowdino or click the link on the left.